Ini menyambut 45 tahun ya penubuhannya. Dan saya ingat lagi waktu jawatankuasa ditubuhkan untuk menubuhkan apa namanya UKM pada masa itu. Universiti Melayu juga dijemput wakil-wakil, taklah saya baru muda sangat. Saya ingat Dr. Rizwan Akil ahlinya daripada Fakulti Ekonomi berbincang macam mana nak tubuhkan UKM. 45 years ago, I was already a lecturer. Of course, I'm 72. I don't know what young, but I'm 72 lah. So that's how long it's been. So I'm glad that for the last 45 years, UKM has made, has had notches of successes and you've churned out so many graduates from all kinds of disciplines. And I was surprised to hear that today now you have a corpus here, is it? Apa benda ni corpus-corpus ni? Badan sudahlah. Badan, core. It's like I was telling Prof. Zuki. Engineering core, imagine corpus engineering. Ni yang pakai lanyak aja translation ni lah dia. You know, I was telling him the last time when I was in cabinet, nak cerita before I start ya. Just to ease the tension sikit. I remember telling him just now, we were going to present the Insurance Brokers Act in Parliament, so we went to cabinet. Lepas itu, aktanya di Inggeris kan, original sah-sahai Inggeris, tadi tak ada translation Melayu masa itu. Isi dalamnya apa tau broker ni? Barua. Can you imagine kawan-kawan saya ni tak rajin baca? Saya ni bekas cikgu universiti, lecturer universiti, rajin lah baca paper kan? Saya tanya Tuan Mahathir, sir, ni apa cerita ni pula kita dalam akta ni ada barua ni? Mana? Ni tengok everywhere there's a broker barua. Nobody cared to even think what it means. Ini barua ni untuk apa? Broker ni bukan barua insurance. See, when you translate, nak corpus lah bunyinya. Maksudnya, change it lah, tukar benda ni, apa ni, Madeline. Jadi, saya terima kasih lah kerana sudi jemput pada hari ini dan saya gembira. Bahkan bila sebut syarahan Tun Fatimah Hashim, bagi saya simbolik. Kerana Alhamdulillah Tun Fatimah lah yang bawa saya masuk politik. For the record. Dan beliau buat bawa saya masuk politik bukan tanpa bukan dengan jemputan ke, tak ada. Satu hari kami nak melancarkan Angkasa, Angkatan Kerjasama Malaysia. Saya naik presidennya, Kuan Aziz presiden, dan yang nak melancar ialah Aliarah Tun Razak. Jadi very big function dekat Dewan Tengku Chancellor. Jadi saya ni chairman organizing committee. Kita muda naik presiden kan, lincah sikit. Kuan Aziz suruh lah kita jadi chairman. Kita berduduklah pukul 6 lebih dah sampai dah. Greeting lah semua orang. Saya tengok kabinet minister ni yang datang ni semua. Tahniah ya, tahniah. Saya ingat ke tahniah kita punya function ni yang 3,000 orang nak hadir ni. Oh, megah lah kan, bagus lah. Lepas tu, Alhamdulillah Tun Fatimah datang. Bukan tahniah lagi, dia pegang tangan saya tepi, bawa ke tepi. Awak ni, saya nak beritahu ya, jangan tolak. Apa dia Datin? Masa tu Datin lagi. Saya dah lantik awak biro ekonomi. Ha? Biro ekonomi apa? Biro ekonomi wanita. Ya ke, awak jangan tolak tau. Nama awak dah gambar dah keluar sok khabar. Macam itu kita masuk politik dulu tau. Nama awak dah keluar sok khabar dengan gambar. Ya, padahal orang ni bertahniah kita rupanya tahniah biro ekonomi bukan angkasa punya cerita. Macam mana nak tolak? Tapi syukur Alhamdulillah saya muda, umur 25, tak salah saya, 25-26. Jadi muda sangat. Jadi maknanya masa itu masuk politik ialah di mana orang cari kita. Nampak celik sikit, ambil dah kita ni dengan apa kata orang kecil sepat tangan, talam kita tadahkan kerana sudinya yang senior-senior masuk kita. Itu dalam tahun 72. Kemudian setahun lepas itu Tun Razak Arham pula buat Biro Ekonomi UMNO. Saya pula lantik lagi. Dah lah kita dah macam anak orang, anak-anak lah semua ni senior kan. Semuanya geng ayah-ayah saya. Ayah saya punya geng. Bila kita muda 20 macam itu tahun, maka kita tahulah kita ni sebenarnya janganlah nak straight-straight jadi pemimpin. Saya heran tau berapa kali seminar dalam beberapa bulan ni aja. Semua nak jadi pemimpin. Menuju kepimpinan, menghala kepimpinan ini nak berjalan, nak jadi pemimpin. Tak ada siapa nak jadi pendeko. Semua jadi pemimpin. Apa cerita ni? I don't understand this. Every seminar is talking about leadership. Everybody wants to be a leader. I'm so afraid No good cars left. Jadi oleh dengan itulah mulanya saya start berkata masuk ke dalam arena politik, arena kancah kerajaan. Biro Ekonomi UMNO awal 74 asal saya, lepas itu ahli Esko Wanita, ahli Majlis Tertinggi tahun 75, bertanding menang sampailah 2013. Saya the longest serving Majlis Tertinggi member ever. Saya rasa yang ada ni tak boleh hidup lama dalam MT. Tak boleh hidup lama dalam MT maksud saya kan. Punya rebut-merebut nyari ni. Dulu tak ada, dia bagi jalan je kita. Akhir-akhirnya baru sibuk nak jatuh-jatuh. Lepas tu masuk NCWO, Ramani ada sama. Tak payah datuk-datuk kami ni. Panggil nama je, we know each other so well. How, decades ago, right? 40 years ago, Ramani lah. That's how far we go. Jadi dengan itu penglibatan kita, saya masuk politik, masuk kerajaan, bawa masuk kerajaan tahun 76 oleh Alirham Tun Hussein. Lepas tu daripada Susun Parlimen 1976 jadi Deputy Minister of Finance tahun 77, Minister of Public Enterprise tahun 80, tahun 87 MITI. Barulah dipencinkan oleh Dolah Badawi dalam tahun 2009. Dipencinkan. Kerana dia kata we want they want a new minister, kata dia. Saya tak tanya lah dia siapa they tu. Ya kan dia ndak, dia kata they want a new minister. So I told him very good, it's okay. So ini Rafidah Aziz lah cakap kan. Jadi saya ingin mengatakan bahawa bila saya masuk politik dulu, it's not about what shall I do now in politics, what's my master plan. No such nonsense. Masuk kat situ, first thing learn. Kerana yang duduk depan saya tu siapa? Tun Razak, Tun Ismail, Tun Sa'dun. Semua nama yang kita tengok memperjuangkan kemerdekaan. Semuanya tanya kat saya, apa khabar bapak awak, ayah awak? Pasal mereka sama menubuhkan pemuda UMNO. So in other words, I started in politics, being brought in for one thing, but learning from Kak Datin, arwah, in the wanita side, and the men side, learning from the giants of politics. Orang-orang yang betul perjuangkan kemerdekaan. Orang yang mentadbir negara pada masa itu. Orang yang menyusun dasar-dasar bawa pembangunan. Jadi saya bertuah. Kerana umur begitu muda, duduk bersama, Tengkuk Abdul Rahman kita kenal. Saya nak tanya di sini, sebut Tengkuk Abdul Rahman baca buku je kan? Saya, dia panggil nama Rafidah je kan? Ini kita tahu. Dah kenal. Jadi maknanya rasa bertuah tu cukuplah. Makna kita menengok orang yang memerdekakan negara sampailah hari ni. Yang nak jahanam pun banyak dah. Jadi proses pembelajaran menjadi utama masuknya politik saya awal-awal dulu. Dan kita tengok cara mereka mengadakan memimpin, cara mereka mengatasi masalah, cara mereka menyatukan rakyat dan cara mereka menggerakkan proses kemajuan masyarakat dan negara pada masa itu. Dan saya, macam kata saya tadi, tak adalah perancangan untuk peribadi, strategi master plan ke mana nak pergi. Tak adalah cerita nak berjalan ke pimpinan, tak ada. Never in my mind. Kerana saya masa kerja kat universiti. I was still a lecturer. Simultaneously in politics. Masa tu tak ada akta college dan universiti. So that's a beauty. So bila saya dilantik senator ahli Dewan Negara dalam tahun 74, saya juga ahli senat universiti. So it's something yang saya experience yang mungkin takkan experience lagi. Kerana mana boleh senator universiti, senat universiti kan? Masuk universiti ahli Dewan Negara. So, maknanya senario pada masa itu lain. Jadi bermakna kami universiti boleh berkecimpung dalam politik. Tapi kita pula tidak pula menyalahgunakan. Bahkan Tan Sri Mahyudin tu student saya tu. Tan Sri Mahyudin, student saya. Seperti juga Rahim Tan Bicik. Seperti juga Tan Sri Osman, Samsudin Osman, KSN dulu. Ni semua student saya. Bekas, saya kadang tak ingat. Dia tanya, dia sebut sendiri. Bila dia berucap, semua sebut. Pasal, yalah, cikgu mana nak kenal anak murid banyak kan? Unless you are very brilliant, or unless you are really rogue. Those yang biasa-biasa, not easy to remember, ramai kan? Student first year, 1,169. By the time you end up with the final year students, there only about 100 plus tinggal lah kan? Still too many lah. Specializing lah in our economics. So in other words, kita tahu bahawa bila dalam universiti tu, boleh kita implementasikan apa kita belajar dalam politik di universiti. Dan saya masa itu juga cuba mumpuk semangat. Masa kita belum ada semangat kebangsaan katakan ya untuk perjuangan. Kita dalam politik mulalah mumpuk semangat. Dan cuba melakukan apa yang boleh, apa yang baik untuk negara. Itu sebabnya saya dengan NCWO nak sebut di sini on record dengan Alaraham dan Tun Fatimah on record, mesti direkodkan. Perjuangan dalam NCWO membawa perubahan-perubahan dalam perundangan, perubahan dalam segala prosedur untuk memberi wanita hak saksama dalam ekonomi negara. Don't you ever forget that. Don't you ever forget that. People like Ramani, Rasmah, Bubalan, who we still get into contact. Of course, led by Tun Fatimah lah, Alayahamah. Lepas itu Kak Isah, tapi inside NCWU tidak lah ya, she still politik. Saya masih dalam, saya vice president. I was actually deputy president pada NCWU satu masa dahulu. Dan melalui inilah kami membawa undang-undang dalam parlimen yang akhirnya bawa ke parlimen. First of all, equal pay for equal work. Permanent status for working women in civil service. Dulu civil service semuanya wanita adalah temporary. Graduate sama, masuk sama, but you are temporary. Can you imagine? Tak kena sakit hati. Tapi kita tak pandai lah nak photo op kan. We don't use newspaper. No such thing. We just did our own work. Remember Ramani? Do our own paper, panggil Mary Cannon from America. Remember? To set up the Bureau Wanita in the PM's department. Lepas tu kita beransur kepada separate assessment for income tax. And then we branch out into monogamous marriage bill. Kepada undang-undang syariah penceraian nikah cerai yang seragam seluruh Malaysia. So that's how we branch out, doing it for the good of women. Hari ini alhamdulillah, whatever has been done as a foundation before has been improved on with time, and the women of today, which is all of you, are benefiting, and I'm sure will benefit. Jadi itulah yang saya lihat bila saya mula-mula terlibat dalam politik. Tapi mauduknya, or the conclusion of that participation early on, ialah ada kesedaran yang datang ke diri saya tentang beberapa perkara. Pertamanya, kesedaran konteks pemimpin dan kepimpinan. I began to think at that time already, what are leaders? What's leadership is all about? Saya berfikir, apakah faktor yang menentukan pemimpin dan menentukan kepimpinan? I was young, but I started to think, what is all these leaders about? These are our leaders yang duduk depan saya ni lah ya, yang bayar ayah saya ni. What are the characteristics that make them leaders? What is it so special about them that allowed them to negotiate with the British and we got independence? That allowed us to bring that country up to that level where so many other countries didn't manage to do it. And observation macam inilah yang sampai hari ini ingat pada ingatan saya, yang meyakinkan saya bahawa bila sebut pemimpin, dia tak ada kena-mengena dengan jawatan. It's got nothing to do with position or post or designation. Pemimpin itu ialah orangnya, it's a person. That's the leader, not the post. Kepimpinan juga bukan post atau position atau jawatan. Kepimpinan ialah sifat orang itu memimpin. So you have to be very careful. Kadang-kadang kita letak tonggok ngedek ke situ, kan dia pemimpin. Iya. Yeah, so many sejarah kan negeri Cina ingat. Puppet emperor lah, the power behind the throne kan. Tidak, takkan ada konsep ini kan. The power behind the throne macam-macam. So we're not talking about Malaysia, I'm talking about the concept of leadership throughout history. Jadi bila kita cakap konteks kepimpinan ini, saya ingin mengatakan bahawa dalam hidup kita mempunyai banyak lingkungan pengaruh. Kita mempunyai circles of influence. That's how it all started as far as I'm concerned. So in society, in life, ada circles of influence, lingkungan pengaruh. Let's start with the basic of all. I'm a very simple person and I'm a very realistic person. Saya tak suka cakap teori. The first one is asas masyarakat, iaitu kepimpinan dan circle of influence dalam keluarga. The family circle of influence. Lepas itu barulah naik ke tingkat lain. Lepas family as a basis, then you go into society where you have organizations, institutions and all kinds of structures. Sampailah right to the top, government. Then prime minister, this is how we normally see it. And then in the private sector, then you have all these companies, multinationals and so on. So in other words, the structure starting from family unit, branching out, up like that. Yeah. Then kita lihat bahawa dalam structure yang sedemikian, terdapat pemimpin in every circle of influence. And dalam every circle of influence itu mesti ada orang yang memimpin yang mempunyai sifat-sifat kepimpinan. Kalau tidak, setiap circle itu tidak akan berjaya. So the first circle of influence ialah keluarga. Now, bagi saya, tak usah cakap banyak-banyaklah cerita. Kalau keluarga tak betul, negara tak betul. Negara ni apa? It's a society made up of units of families. Yeah. Hari ini timbul masalah macam-macam ni mula pada mana? Bukan mula pada dasar kerajaan. Bukan mula pada Perdana Menteri. Kurang ajar di rumah. Betul tidak? Kurang kepimpinan di rumah ibu bapa. Mak bapak sibuk berpolitik, mak bapak sibuk entah apa benda dia buat, anak tu tak pandai diajar. Bercakap berapi-rapi. Dia nak bina negara ni. Anak sendiri di rumah tunggang-langgang. Termasuklah wanita. Siapa makan cili rasa pedas. Tuan Fatimah anak ni semua menjadi. Alhamdulillah betul. Anak saya pun alhamdulillah menjadi semua. Tiga je pun tapi jadilah mak dia kan. Mak dia tak bercakap je buat kat rumah. Nak bina keluarga ni more effort than bina negara tau. Bina negara ni ada KSU, ada macam kan. Bina rumah apa? Ada apa? Tak ada. Kita lah. Joint venture partner. Kalau joint venture partner kita tak guna, habislah. Kita seorang lah. Betul tidak? Jadi puan-puan sekalian, baliklah pada keluarga tadi saya nak terang. Parenting, keibubapaan, parenting ialah satu aspek kepimpinan yang sangat penting dalam sebuah negara. Especially now. Saya akan terangkan apa maksud saya kemudian. Kerana ini ialah kunci kepada segala-galanya untuk negara dan masyarakat. Kerana asasnya di dalam keluarga itu kepimpinan ibu bapa ialah mendidik anak. Anak ni jadi muda. Kita selalu kata awaklah harapan negara. Yang cakap ni mak bapak ni, kamulah harapan negara. Tapi dia tak buat kerja dia. Mendidik harapan negara ni. Cakap je pandai. Apa maksud saya mendidik anak-anak? Pertamanya, apa yang kita lakukan dalam rumah tangga sebagai ibu bapa, sebagai pemimpin circle influence kecil ni, dalam menyemai nilai-nilai positif. Di mana anak belajar nilai negatif kalau tidak di rumah. Yang positif pun di rumah juga. Prinsip hidup, kita lah yang mengajar. Motivasi, kita lah yang mengajar menanam bibit-bibitnya. Contoh baik, kita lah mula. Anak celik mata tengok kita lah, bukan tengok cikgu. Jangan lupa dia masuk sekolah umur berapa. Masuk kindergarten umur berapa. Sebelum hantar pergi kindergarten, siapa dia tengok dulu. Hari ni tengok bibit. Jangan lupa. Betul tidak? Jadi inilah kesilapan keibubapaan. Ini kebapa-bibian. Juga dalam didikan tadi kita ajar anak untuk hidup bermasyarakat. Kita nak ajar anak di Malaysia ni hidup perpaduan. Kalau dekat rumah mak tanya, awak kawan tak dengan siapa-siapa? Dia tu kawan dengan mana? Kawan dengan orang Islam je tau. Orang kapir jangan berkawan. How are you going to get united Malaysia? When the parents tell the children, make sure you make friends only with the Islam people, you know, otherwise you eat don't know what, I don't know lah, macam-macam kan. Ada mak bapak. Menyemai tak payahlah 10 ribu, cukuplah 100, 200 satu Malaysia ni, they will grow. Saya dulu kecil-kecil nak masuk convent, sendiri pergi enroll untuk exam. Kawan-kawan saya kata apa? Awak ni dah Nasrani ya? Kenapa? Saya nak masuk convent, apa salahnya? Awak ni tak, Berani awak ya? Ni budak-budak kecil ni. Bapak saya kata tu masuk Nasrani ke lebih konven. Pasal kan cross banyak tu. Takkanlah duduk dalam konven ada cross kita tu tu kan jadi Kristian. Nipis sangat iman kita. Betul tak? Hari ni tengok cross orang tak boleh. Tak sangka nak masuk tengok orang punya cross, orang punya church, orang punya bangunan. Kita jebuk-jebuk. Siapa? Maknanya you are so thin the veneer of your religion. Correct? You can't even stand to see other people's cross. Padahal Nabi itu Nabi kita juga. Nabi Isa itu Nabi kita kan? Suddenly kita discard pula dia. Pasal apa? Nabi Musa itu Nabi siapa? Nabi kita kan? Just because they call them Moses, we disown them. Just because them Jesus, we disown them. Cuba baca dulu. Baca Quran kita. Kan banyak kali sebut nama Nabi-Nabi ni. Semua ramai Nabi kan? Tapi we don't think that way. Why? Maybe dalam keibubapaan tadi ada kekurangan sikit. This is what I'm trying to say moving forward kepimpinan. We cannot undo what's done in the past. The future we can still correct. Jadi tadi hidup bermasyarakat, especially in Malaysia. It has to start with the family. Kemudian semangat kebangsaan. Kalau hari ini dalam gini cacah merbahnya politik hari ini kan, mak bapak di rumah, depan anak tu, start condemn segala-gala yang ada. Tak berguna lah kerajaan, tak berguna itu, tak berguna. Anak dia dengar. Bila masa dia nak jadi orang patriotik pada negara. Kan dia kata, mak saya dengan bapak saya condemn. Dia kata, tak elok lah kerajaan ni. Tak elok lah negara ni. Budak kecil kan? How are we going to get? And blog banyak. Dia baca blog. Dia baca Facebook. Dia baca tweet. Tak ada yang positif. Where is this? Where are we going? Jadi semangat kebangsaan didik kat rumah dulu. Cikgu tak ada masa. Dia nak murid nak 35 orang. Right? And di rumah ni 2-3 kerat je kita boleh buat. Hormat pada orang. Orang tua, hormat pada diri, hormat pada wanita, hormat pada masyarakat. Hormat kepada harta awam. Di rumah aja. Teach at home. Nah, mengapa saya katakan ni semua? Begitu juga membuat keputusan dalam rumah tangga. Itu akan determine the future of your kids. The kind of things you prepare for the education. Investments you make for the future. The discipline you teach in the house. Kalau ada television show, you sendiri sibuk. Macam mana nak belajar? Esok ada exam. Kita tengok huha-huha, apa lawak-lawak apa tu. Maharaja lawak. Dia nak buat SRP, SPM, I don't know lah apa. Anak saya dah cucu, anak tak ada. Anak tiga-tiga dah, semua dah 30-40 tahun. Dia nak exam esok, kita dengan raja lawak. That's not the environment to educate, right? So that's the kind of thing, the decisions you make in the house that flow to your children. Now, when you talk about that, the leadership in the family becomes very critical. Also, how you bring up the children to be honest, that's very important. If you bring up the children on corrupt money, what else do they know? What else do they know? Father earn 3,000, neighbor earn 3,000, father jolly, mother jolly. Those fellows next door are just normal life. What do they think the children, what do you think the children will feel? Must be side income besar lah kan? Income 3,000, side income 30,000, 300,000. It's corruption. You're teaching the child very early. So then when you go up into society, we then scream about corruption. You see where the relationship of kepimpinan keluarga now. Most people won't even care about keluarga. I do. Kalau saya nak buat teori senang, cakap kan? Wah, blah, 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 blah. I'm talking about reality. Jadi hari ini saya nak kata kepimpinan di dalam lingkungan pengaruh asas keluarga itu adalah critical bagi semua masyarakat. Kerana anak-anak ini akan jadi pemimpin masa depan. Mereka akan jadi ahli politik, ahli swasta, mereka lah yang akan menentu dasar, mereka lah ahli perniagaan, mereka lah teknokrat dan mereka pula akan jadi ibu bapa baru. The new parents. They will learn from the old parents what is good or bad. See how parenting gets inherited. Dan juga mereka, apabila mereka megang semua jawatan ini, akan menentukan hala dan haluan masyarakat dan negara. They become the determinants of society and country. So, first remember the basic kepimpinan. Yeah? Jalan kepimpinan jangan jauh lah. Don't walk, don't move very far to seek leadership. Stay in your own house. That's where leadership starts. Ni nak berjalan je, semua nak berjalan je ni. Daripada rumah jadi Perdana Menteri, daripada rumah nak jadi CEO. Kemudian, di luar keluarga. Di sini banyaklah lingkungan pengaruh. Kita ada dalam kerajaan, dalam awam, dalam swasta dan juga dalam masyarakat umumnya. Dan sini kita tahulah, di luar masyarakat, di luar keluarga ada orang pembuat dasar, pembuat keputusan, pelaksana dasar, penggerak pembangunan. Taknya kita nak mencapai wawasan 2020 dan selepas 2020, these are the people critical moving the country forward. Dan orangnya juga pembentuk minda, mind shapers, these are the teachers, these are the lecturers, the shapers of minds. Dan juga pendidik. Dan semua ni dalam setiap kategori saya kata tadi adalah circles of influence sendiri. Dan mereka harus mempunyai pemimpin-pemimpin yang juga mampu menggerakkan apa yang patut digerak untuk membawa masyarakat dan negara ke hadapan. Dan mereka haruslah berupaya menghasilkan matlamat sasaran dan sasaran, meningkatkan prestasi, membawa kemajuan berterusan dan memberi impak yang positif. Contohnya, dalam kerajaan, very easy to see. Kita ada kabinet, kerajaan negeri, perkhidmatan awam, di pusat, negeri dan di daerah. Kita ada kerajaan tempatan, ada agensi. Hari ini yang kita sibuk dengan wanita ialah 30% dalam board. 30% keputusan dasar. Bila keputusan dasar tengok atas je. MP, wakil rakyat. Sebenarnya, hari ini orang dah salah. Saya kata wakil rakyat, dia kata member of parlimen. Kerana member parlimen ni, ahli parlimen berucap kat dewan. Wakil rakyat kerja kat bawah sana. Stop calling them member parlimen. Start calling them the people's representatives. Tapi hari ni semua nak jadi wakil rakyat. Saya nak tanya berapa ekor, berapa kerat yang kerja sebagai wakil rakyat di kawasan. Ni, parit pecah, lampu tak ada. Sabah Sarawak tanyalah Madeline. Berapa peratus yang ada rumah ke apa, dia tak? Betul tak? She's nodding. Alah, payah jauh Sarawak. Sini sudahlah. Masuk je lah kampung tengok. Maksud saya mula jadi wakil rakyat di Kuala Kangsar. 42% je kampung tu ada electricity. 48% dah jadi air. Yang lain tu air apa? Air Sungai Perak. When I first came, I said, my God, saya kan duduk KL. Buka je paik petik KL. Sampai Kuala Kangsar saya naik boat. Gile muda pasal tak ada jalan. From one village another no connection. Jadi buat scallop lah. Tebing sungai. Tebing sungai jalan. Masuk naik boat jalan. Jadi I'm scalloping around the river bank. To go from apa village to village on the same side of the bank. Because there's no connecting road. Footpath ada. Tokar tak boleh masuk. Motor pun payah. This was 1982. So nak jadi wakil rakyat bukanlah suruh WTO lah. Wakil rakyat ialah tengok mana nak dibuatnya. Apa orang asli duduk atas gunung tu, apa yang tak ada. Semua tak ada. Nothing. They don't have anything. You have to cater for them, right? That's wakil rakyat. Hari ni duduk bilang wanita berapa puluh nak jadi wakil rakyat. Astaghfirullahalazim. Nak jadi ahli parlimen. Nak masuk sok khabar. Dia punya ucapan. Betul tak? Apa guna ucap berapi? Okay, orang di kampung tak ada api. Begitu juga kita tengok di peringkat-peringkat pengaruh tadi. Kalau dalam sebuah kementerian, bukan menteri yang memimpin seorang. Banyak level kepimpinan lagi. KSU ada, jabatan ketua jabatan ada, betul tak? To me, chief of security is pemimpin. Betul tak? Tak jaga security habis komputer di siapa orang. No, seriously, university ni don't talk about security tu. You have so much valuable stuff here, right? If the chief security in the university is a cincai fellow, not a pemimpin, you're going to be dead. Correct? Ha, inilah maknanya. Janganlah tengok nak jadi CEO kat atas saja, nak jadi menteri semua orang. Decision making happens at all levels. That's what I said. You look at the lingkungan pengaruh, circle of influence, and become the good leader wherever you are there. In other words, each one of you can be a leader in your own area. Jangan nak tengok ke atas. We are very fond looking up. Bila kita tengok ke atas, kita teringin dah orang tu punya. You don't realize that where you are, you can be a leader. More effective than the guy upstairs. Correct? Tapi tak, manusia ni tengok yang atas tu runtun turun kan. When in fact you can be the best where you are here. That's human nature. So please change our attitude. Dalam swasta begitu juga, saya dah jelak dengar ni. Nak jadi board of directors, nak jadi chairman, nak jadi CEO. Masya Allah. Have you forgotten that decision making in the private sector, in the company, doesn't rest with the board of members, board of directors, doesn't rest with the chairman. It happens at all levels. What's the point of having women sitting there as quota fillers for 30% if they're not effective in monitoring what's been put up on the table for discussion, right? Most of the time, the decisions are actually made collectively from down there. You don't get brilliance at the board suddenly. Shall we do this? You can have a suggestion, but it got to be studied right down the line, right? Macam saya lah, some flash of brilliance. Ooh, shall we fly to some exotic place? Kat mana nak pergi? Teringat kan? Shall we fly to Kazakhstan? Or shall we fly to... more, ni apa namanya, apa ni? Tony nak pergi Hawaii. Let's fly to name is Tahiti. Ha, kan? Saya dah pergi Tahiti, exotic lah tu. Shall we fly to Easter Island, Christmas Island mana kan? We fancy. Tu management kalau yang cengedik kata, I don't think it's practical. Because there's no load there, load factor. Kalau ada load tu pergi je, balik tak ada. Well, Easter Island tak ada nak balik sini, datang. So, empty plane lah kan, half the time. Takkan orang Easter Island tu duduk 2 hari balik kan? Nak tunggu dia orang balik tu, kenalah tunggu seminggu. So, what do you do in the meantime? In other words, I as a chairman can make wonderful suggestions. Cari bodoh je lah kata orang. So, how does a company work? Down there, the strategic planners, right? The financial directors, all those fellows down there, they study. It could be idea from me, but they study dulu. Then they come back and say, it's feasible provided we do like this. Or it's not feasible. So, when you understand the structure, then you don't make this noise about wanting to be board member je lah. To become quota filler. You would rather have people making decisions at all levels, right? These are the specialists. To me, it's good to have women down there. So that by the time the paper goes to the board, it's well thought of by capable women. Kadang-kadang men ni cincai je, Basuki. Nak tengok ada he's asleep atau tak? Jadi semuanya level-level ni buat keputusan. So the next time you hear about somebody wanting to be board director, you say, what about the financial director? Don't you want it to be a woman? Correct? What about that strategic planner, that investment planner? Don't you want women there? Board director ni di 3 bulan sekali, once in 3 months. Nak pergi meeting tu set rambut dulu. Because 3 months. Yeah, got time even to see which dress, which colour, macam I lah ini kan. Because I don't have office hours, so I want to be red today. I have afford the luxury. Got meeting, board meeting, I think I'll wear blue. This financial director has no time, she's very busy. Correct? So is that what we want? 30% board membership? Is that what we're talking about? No. I'd rather have one woman who can actually overwhelm the rest of the men. Then 30% of women and anggo, yeah, saya setuju. Yes, masa tak baca? Kalau tak baca, tak faham. I'm serious. And then the men don't even respect you. Oh, you're here because 30%. Oh, malunya saya. Unless you all tak malu, tak apalah. Betul tak? Don't be a quota filler. So, you have your own circle of influence. Be a leader there. Dan berebut nak jadi semua ni. As I've said, board of directors only once in 3 months meeting. And then CEO. I don't mind kalau capable and married. Yes, we want CEO. Of course. But don't just look at CEO ni. CEO seorang. Ni, the support structure of the CEO ni. Banyak ni. So to me, When you talk about lingkungan, lingkungan pengaruh, circles of influence where you can provide leadership, remember, in every structure, there are many levels, there are many areas. And we want women everywhere. And not 30%. As many as can be. Mazuki dah senyum. Perempuan tu sekalian, begitu juga setiap lingkungan pengaruh tu penting. Dan ia menyumbang secara kolektif kepada kekesanan sesebuah organisasi. It's a collective decision making or levels that make the organisation effective. Whether it's university, whether it's cabinet, whatever. Whether it's company. Sekarang kita tanyalah. Tadi saya kata pemimpin dan kepimpinan. Saya sekarang nak bagi pendapat saya mengenai apakah yang dikatakan pemimpin. Bagi saya, pemimpin itu ialah orang-orang yang mempunyai sifat-sifat asas yang tertentu yang boleh membawa perbezaan, bring a difference and boleh memperbaiki keadaan, make it better. Ya, jangan lead betul-tuli je, make things better. Dan tadi saya dah kata ibu bapa kita tahu apa dia kerja dia. Kadang-kadang ibu dan bapa tu juga ketua jabatan. Doesn't mean that as ibu bapa different sifat, ketua jabatan different sifat. Tak. Bagi saya sifat kepimpinan cuts across. Doesn't matter what role you assume. Whether you are at the same time mother or father, the same time ketua jabatan, whether at the same time you are minister, or at the same time you are naib chancellor, at the same time you are lecturer, it does not matter. The sifat kepimpinan in every circle of influence must be the same. Now, what are they? To me, first is integrity. I have no compromise about integrity. To me, it is key, it is vital, it moves everything. And integrity is the one that actually becomes responsible for a person's actions, a person's decision making, and a person's motivation. Semuanya berpunca daripada integrity. And kita kat Malaysia ni kalau integrity buat institute. To me, integrity is a principle of life, not a subject in the institute. You know what I mean? It's like morality. It's not institute of morality. It's a daily practice. It's not an institute of religion. It's a daily practice. No, tak. Sebut integrity, institute of integrity. Sebut perpaduan, institute of harmony. Besok institute of marriage. Institute of parenting. Find institutes for everything. When in fact the things has got to do with sifat, has got to do with principle and principles of life. Jadi integrity. Ianya merangkum banyak perkara. When you talk about integrity, ia menyentuh amanah. Ia menyentuh sifat bertanggungjawab. Accountability. Kenal antara baik dan buruk. Betul dan tidak. Dan berpegang kepada prinsip doing what is right. I don't believe in saying do what is good. Because good ni very subjective. Betul tak? Good for you, not good for me. Good for me, good for you, not good for you. Tapi kalau right, it cuts across. Right has got a criteria and benchmarks, right? So what is right universally is right. So when you have integrity, you can differentiate between what is right and what is wrong. And we'll also influence the motivation for doing something. It also is a motivation for decision making. It also shapes the way you act, the way you do things. And it also has impact upon how you act, from how you act and impact upon how you decide. For example, orang ketua jabatan. Kalau dia bertindak didorongi oleh nafsu dia, rasuah ataupun dollar sign kat biji mata, maka dia punya decision making tu lain lah. Dia akan beri tender untuk kat universiti ya, Mazuki. Not to the best lah, but to the one who can, so go correct. The one yang technically not competent pun dapat. You're engineer, you know what I mean kan? All your technical specs are like this. Tapi because this guy has got some sweetener, so kita, okay lah, kita adjust sikit. Itu yang tu ada yang untuh stadium. Kan? Bukannya dah dongeng saya cakap ni. Correct or not? I'm sure di universiti ni over the years Mak Zuki ada kan? No, I'm serious. It may be a small matter somewhere. Tender makan tu dah lah catering. Kan? I mean, this is life. Kalau the motivation of the person making the decision is not based on integrity, so the impact is all the kind of things of substandard delivery, unnecessary cost, and of course all the inefficiencies and leakages. So that's a cost to masyarakat, right? But why? Because decision making not motivated by integrity. Jadi perempuan sekalian, to me, integrity is so important. You can go on from there. Second is discipline. This is very important juga kerana dia mempengaruhi sama ada kepimpinan dan pemimpin tu efektif, cekap atau lembap, berstrategi ataupun tidak, ataupun cuma atas nama yang memimpin, menganggapkan kerusi je. So discipline. Now what is discipline about? I'm very particular about one, discipline of the mind. Kalau discipline of the mind tak ada, pemimpin tu terponyoklah duduk zaman 30 atau 30-an dulu, pre-independence time. Okay, dia punya mindset. Time management, discipline of time. We have to change this. In Malaysia, time discipline is, I think, something we have to learn to do. Cara berfikir mesti berdisiplin. Cara bertindak mesti berdisiplin. Dan kita mesti jadi pemimpin yang contoh baik kepada orang lain. Discipline to me is very important because you have the need to understand the parameters within which you operate. Kita tak boleh tindak, pemimpin tak boleh tindak ikut suka. Kita ada parameters of law, parameters of rules, right? So jadi bila kita berdisiplin, kita faham, ini bertindak, ini dia punya parameters. Kita buat, ini dia parameters. Maka dengan disiplin itu, kepimpinan kita berkesan. Tidak violate apa-apa yang tak betul. Dan kita menjadi, macam saya kata tadi, kepimpinan melalui tauladan. Dah hilang dah dia punya saying ni. Dulu masa saya muda ni, kepimpinan melalui tauladan. You remember? Ingat tak? Before some of you born. Hari ni tak sebut dah. Why? Tak ada apa yang nak teladan. Ketiga, satu lagi dia punya ciri-ciri dan sifat ialah rajin. Rajin, in English, diligence. Saya nak kata, pemimpin tak bolehlah kerja kuat. Dia kena kerja bijak. Kerja kuat ni kadang-kadang macam cockroach on a pin. Ni cockroach, ini pin. Ni cockroach, lipas. Lipas tu, you terbalikkan lipas tu, you cocok dia, belakang dia. 6 kaki dia bergerak, macam nak gerak. Tapi tak ke mana. Dia kerja kuat tu. Betul tak? So, never be a cockroach on a pin when you lead. Bergerak macam nak gerak, tak berjalan. He stuck there because mindset dia stuck. Betul tak? He stuck there because mindset, negativity or whatever. So jangan sebut lagi. So in the university never say, oh, I'm working very hard. Remember the cockroach. Work smart. Kalau nak jadi pemimpin, kerja bijak. Time management, discipline. Itu maksud saya tadi. Ya. Dan bila kita kata rajin, maknanya dedikasi, committed. And also team player. Jangan nak jadi pemimpin aja, must be a team player. Kadang-kadang kita mimpin, kita arah orang. Saya dah banyak sangat tengok. Dekat bawah saja mimpin, lingkungan dia bawah je. Tapi sibuknya. Kadang kita datang ni kan nak ambil gambar. Katalah nak ambil gambar. Kursi banyak. Nak tunggu panggil orang ke hall tu. Datang tak pada mana nak ngatur kursi tadi. Padahal dia boleh ambil kursi tu. Atur kan. Tanda kan bos. Panggil lah tukang daripada mana tak datang, boleh lagi turun. Saya lah buat sendiri. Bila dah saya angkat kursi, baru yang lain mengangkat kursi. Nak nunggu orang tu datang pasal apa ni, kita sendiri boleh buat. Allah, hey. Tak turun jatuh maruah kan, betulkan kursi pun tu. But leaders, because I'm a leader, how can I do it? Jadi maknanya not a team player lah. arah je pandai. When time the crunch is, oh sorry, how can I pick up that paper, you know? Ada pernah jumpa orang macam tu? Ada. Okay. Enough said. Begitu juga orang yang merajin ni tadi, dia mampu mendorongkan dan memotivasikan pengikut-pengikutnya. Dia rajin untuk motivate enthusiasm, to get collective passion, collective enthusiasm. Kan dia seorang aja macam cockroach dia tadi. Dia rajin untuk menggerakkan semangat team player dia for better performance. Juga dia sentiasa menentukan benchmark yang semakin tinggi. Always maintaining very high levels of benchmarking of performance. And I would like to tell you, you can have two choices. One is the limbo rock performance benchmark or the pole vaulter benchmark. Nah, siapa yang sejaman dengan saya, limbo rock tahu kan? Maksudnya, tahu tak? Kalau no tu muda. Okay, limbo rock was an old dance masa saya muda. Ya, yeah? Dia buat dia macam rentang apa main sepak apa takraw lah kan? Bar. Chubby checker. Jadi dia jawab dia macam ni, you melentang lah. Dia main lah lagu limbo rock tu, you buat macam ni, cross, ya. Yeah? And it goes lower and lower. And the tagline, how low can you go? Alright, that's one benchmark. The other benchmark is the pole vaulter. Ni yang lompat pagar tu, lompat tinggi tu. Yang bawa kan, cium. Dia punya benchmark macam mana nampak kalah? Daripada ini dia naik, right? How high can you go? Pilih lah. Pemimpin yang nak bawa team dia, how low can you go? Limbo rock? Atau pemimpin yang nak bawa team dia, prestasi tertinggi, pole vaulter. That's what I mean by benchmarking. Kemudian begitu juga, performance for excellence. That's a hallmark of a pemimpin. Dia demand excellence. Dan dia dulu buatlah excellence, jangan demand orang aja. Kita cabut dia orang excellence buat apa? So, dan bila sebut excellence and benchmarks, zaman sekarang ni bukan jago kampung. Zaman sekarang ialah global benchmarks. Universities, please don't compete with each other. Dah jago kampung. Compete with the best. And when you compete with the best, where are you? Limbo rock. Correct or not? You compete among yourselves, kan Malaysia hero lah. And you start competing with those even in Singapore. You limbo rock, dia pole vaulter. This is what I mean by leadership that brings about high benchmarking for performance. So, when you talk about global benchmarks, it must be dalam konteks dunia tanpa sempadan. Dalam konteks ilmu tanpa sempadan, cross flows of ilmu tanpa sempadan. Dalam konteks globalisasi, dalam konteks competition. That's what we're talking about, leadership for today and for the future. Dan dalam konteks perubahan macam ini, leader tu mestilah berjaya mendorong kreativiti dan inovasi. Kerana kita tahu bahawa change has to happen. The only constant is change. And in your own circle of influence, change can happen every day if you are having strong leadership qualities enough to make the changes. Janganlah tunggu dasar kerajaan baru nak ubah. Look into your own circle of influence. There should begin the changes. Go back to the family tadi. There should be the changes of how you run and manage the family. Whether you've been communicating with your kids, whether you have been looking into their school records, whether you've been attending PIBG. Sebagai wakil rakyat, saya selalu marahkan orang-orang di kawasan Kuala Kangsar. Kerana saya tengok bila pergi PIBG, mak aja yang ada. Bapak tak ada. Jadi saya kata tak payah panggil PIBG lah, panggil PIG sudah. Betul tidak? Kenapa? The B itu sibuk. Tak payahlah B. PIG sudah. Persatuan Ibu Guru. It doesn't sound very good as an acronym lah. Mana tak faham tu dia tak ketawa. Mana yang faham tu ketawa habis. So, itulah maksud saya tadi. Supaya kita dalam setiap lingkungan pengaruh tadi buat inovasi. Inovasi ni bukan makmal. Hari ni passion makmal kan? Semuanya makmal. Tak payahlah. Leave the makmal to the scientist. Ni, small little changes. Saya buat changes. Saya bukan cakap je buat. Di MITI. Masa saya, bukan saya jadi MITI, tapi bila saya mula-mula masuk kerajaan, MITI lah banyak file ni. Dulu yang lain-lain tu banyak sangat. Di meeting, first day saya masuk, kerana dia ada, masa saya ambil alih daripada Tegur Zali, dia berapa minggu kan tinggal, masuk je bilik nak pengsan. Kerana dia punya file tinggi daripada saya. Saya 5'3", I think dia 5'6", dengan kat 6 kaki. Belah sini ada file, belah sini ada file, tempat meja, file. File kat luar ada lagi Datin. Hah? File mana datang ni? Apa guna file ni? Ni semua nak bagi keputusan. Oh, mak oi. What is this? What decisions? Why so many files? Rupanya tradisi dan kerajaan ni ialah kalau file katalah Mazuki and Company, engineering company ya, minta insentif, dia set up in 1978, dah ada 3 file. You know, file kan ada 3, dia punya korresponden, apa punya case dia 3 file. Dia main dengan red tape, that's what it's called, red tape. 3 file, that's what, yeah, where do you think red tape comes from? Dia main dengan 3, jadi Mazuki's file di setinggi ni, 3. But bukan saya nak tengok 3 volume. Saya nak tengok kertas yang akhir je. Betul tak? Itu satu Mazuki punya ni yang banyak beratus ni. So actually decision making is actually kalau compilekan paper tu ni gini je. Tapi how to innovate? Senang lah. Panggil admin. Okay, you pergi beli berapa ratus yang ada di kedai tu, plastik factory tu. Plastik folder, masa itu 40 sen ke satu? 60 sen ke? 1987, very cheap. Ini yang clear folder tu. Yang masuk aja kan, flap macam tu je. Ha, macam ni lah, ha. Ni semua clear kan. Ni ada ni di seal, masuk sini, right? Beli, nak buat apa? Begini, tu panggil postcard meeting. Beginilah. Sekarang, mula sekarang, bila dah beli je file ni, semua orang yang mengendalikan file-file, I don't care what level, no more. Sila lihat atas, sila lihat atas. We're not looking at the sky. Pengarah division, Datuk KSU, sila lihat atas. Datuk KSU, Yang Berhormat Menteri, sila lihat atas. Ini semua lihat ke atas. You know what the atas is? The little minute on top. That's how the government works. I think ke Indonesia sama je, Mazuki. Betul tidak? Sila lihat atas, silalah lihat lampiran. Please lihat. Whether you... And I've done it. I've done my job. I have asked him to look and I've asked her to look atas semua. I've done my job. Okay, not up to her, up to him. Saya kata, no more rubbish lihat atas, lihat bawah. No more. From now on, every officer, read the case. Understand it. And in no more than 2 pages maximum, bukan je ringkaskan. Make sure the ringkasan is comprehensive with the body and the prayer. Maknanya body itu cerita, janganlah cerita tahun 78 start. Kan? Nak lihat bawah namanya, file bawah. So, lihat apa? This, you can say 1978 was formed, now ni 3 lines. What is the problem with Mazuki punya file ni? Dia minta insentif. And then you analyse. Mengikut kriteria, memenuhi kriteria. Mengikut kriteria, tak penuhi. Sorry lah for you. Kalau Rafidah Aziz, no way lah. You coming back pun tak dapat. Okay, so the officer place it there. According to criteria, he merits. Recommendation. Doesn't fit the criteria. Yang bawa menteri, disampaikan untuk pertimbangan. Kita mimpin kan? Nak timbang cara mana? Ni Mazuki ni saya kenal ni. Baiklah dia budak tu. Also neighbor ai. Lu tak apalah, bagilah kat dia. Kita menteri kan kuasa. Pegawai kata mengikut semua kriteria tak layak. Tapi kenal, senyum dia bagus. Oh, ada pertimbangan lah. Okay? Itu pertimbangan yang saya kata je je kan, hint-hint aje. I made my own decision, diluluskan. Boleh tak buat macam tu? Tak boleh lah kan? So, when you have this thing so like this, pressing, your officer jelas apa yang dia patut buat, menteri jelas apa yang dia patut buat. Jadi, inovasi saya itulah dia. Sampai hari ni dia buat lagi kat meeting. You don't carry files anymore. You just bring that little 2-page thing, apa, dan saya boleh inovasi kerja. Lepas saja saya habis all the meetings ke apa, saya tengok, oh this clear file. Tak sempat nak buat dekat office, tak apa. Ambil 50 clear file ni, buat balik. Besok pagi ni subuh, buat. So in other words, work goes on. Kalau saya dah buat balik file tinggi ni, kena bawa lori. Kereta tak cukup. Right? So that's what innovation I did. One. Banyak lagi lah, but I'm talking about very clear indicator. But I think ada government servant terus lagi, bawa file jinjir 3-4, betul tak? Universiti je sedar lah Kak Mazuki, tengok lah. I'm sure, right? Still carrying file. Kalau jonjo pun boleh atas kepala. Tahu. So, talking about mengadakan creativity dan innovation, itu kerja pemimpin. You motivate them to make changes. You motivate them to improve. Provide the environment for people to make changes. Ni kena ada allocation. Dia kata tak ada allocation. Okay, get allocation. Misal kata. So, when you do that, the impact is the spin-offs. Good spin-offs and then spin-off of mindsets. Yeah, we better change, we better change, we better change. And so it becomes an innovative culture in the organization. Itu dah tiga tadi, integrity, discipline dan rajin. Sekarang berwawasan, ini bunyi besar sikit lah. Berwawasan ni is nothing more than having a vision looking forward. Kerana kita tidak mahu pemimpin static. Bila saya kata berwawasan, it means that you have an open mind, minda terbuka. Not obsolete minds. Bukan minda yang dikongkong oleh keusangan. Bukan static. Dan bila saya kata minda terbuka, maknanya dia faham pengaruh-pengaruh persekitaran, the influence of environment, domestic environment, serantau global. Cakap universiti je lah. Katakan College of Business, saya adjunct professor UM. You cannot be teaching the same curriculum the last 20 years because business models have changed. Profiles of market and competition have changed. 20 years ago lain kan? So if the College of Business continue to be lecturing the same thing, churn up the same notes, SME kita lingkup lah. If they attend your lecture, correct? Usahawan yang banding-banding ni nak di graduate semua nak jadi usahawan ni, start-start je dah fail. Dekat lecturer dia tak tengok. The lecturer is a pemimpin, remember? Circle of influence dia nak murid lah kan? Student. Bukan PM. Circle of influence is a lecturer. Haha, you think like PM? No, you are the circle leader, your circle influence. You teach the students rubbish, rubbish lah keluar. Teaching of English. I've been told some teachers teach English in Malay. I said, how is that? Oh, macam inilah. Hari ini kita akan belajar noun. Hari ini kita akan belajar verb. Instead of saying, today we will learn about nouns, today we will learn about verbs, today we will learn past participle. You begin in everything in Malay. Maka gini kita buat macam ni. Maka sentence ni jadi macam ni. You can't do that, right? Cuba tengok macam mana orang teach Mandarin. Every word is Mandarin. Saya tahu cucu saya 5-5 belajar Mandarin, dapat A pula tu. Because the discipline of the teaching by the teacher who is the leader of that circle of influence is correct. Saya heran macam mana cucu saya anak Melayu boleh tu buat scribble-scribble tu. Bahasa Melayu B. Aduh, ugut dada. Mandarin A. Apa cerita ni? Saya tanya mak dia. Macam mana nak buat? Bahasa ibunda nak bertabat ni semua ni. UK ni. Berlin ni nak bertabat. Saya talk in Malay. Asyik tak? Ha? Ha? Sama, there you are. Oh yeah, same school. There you are. I'm not joking. Same. My cucu nyanyi boleh cakap Mandarin. Bahasa Malaysia B. I'm so afraid yang kalau buat D malu. Malu kita orang Melayu. Bahasa ibunda tak ada bertabat kan? Macam mana nak bertabat kan? Kat rumah dia pandai cakap Melayu bila dia hadir belajar kat sekolah. Lain terplay out-nya. You see what I mean? The circle of influence ni, cikgu dia tu tak betul mengajar. Correct? So think about everybody being a leader. that adds up to the leadership of the country. That's what I'm trying to get at, beginning with leadership in the home. Jadi berwawasan tadi, the leader in any sphere mesti faham pengaruh dia punya persekitaran. Dia kena faham pengaruh ICT, the use of ICT in every area. This is again in Malaysia not yet fully utilized. Even in some areas, I'm not sure I can challenge some of you, whether you have on your Android your email. Do you have your email set up on your Android? Yet senyap je bunyi. Yes. I know I have friends whom I email, tak jawab sampai dalam setengah pukul 7 malam. So I said, why you don't reply my email? It's quite urgent. Oh no, I only open at night. My computer at home. Huh? What is this? You know, people operate on that little ni. Dia kena ada komputer kat rumah. Phone ni untuk apa? Facebook. Makan. All of you are guilty. Bersama MESCOM UKM. Correct or not? Ha, apa yang tak tag sana, tag sini. You don't even optimize the use of a tool such as your mobile phone. Ha, decorate tu macam dak-gak phone ni tu, dengan beat lah, dengan labuci kat luar ya. Tak guna. So see all the guilty ones. Jadi pemimpin mesti faham pengaruh ICT. Information flow across borders, knowledge flow across borders, which means that you have an open mind towards all this. Alright? Lepas tu kita juga tahu bagaimana berfikir merentasi sempadan. Thinking beyond borders. Now we have ASEAN. How many in universities actually do latch on to the ASEAN concept now? Think ASEAN. We supposed to have ASEAN community, you know, not ASEAN economic community. ASEAN social cultural community. ASEAN security political community. ASEAN economic community. I'd just like to ask, how many universities actually do have an ASEAN program? Yeah, across the board. Tak ada. Adalah satu seminar. Half a day, kan? I'm talking about the culture of ASEAN. Macam mana kita nak jari saya? So if we are not ready, making our youngsters ready, others get ready, when they go into the job market, when they go into the business area, they fall back. Because the circle of influence in the universities didn't prepare them to be ASEAN. Because the leaders in the circles influence, the lecturers, didn't think beyond borders. There. That's what I mean by having that vision. You don't have to visualize your own though. Vision, even having the premise of what's there, or what will be. 2020. How are universities preparing for 2020? I just like what to ask that. How are you preparing for 2020? What are the benchmarks of education? What are the benchmarks of mental aptitudes? What are the benchmarks of excellence in performance of education for 2020, which is a developed country? Are we doing it? I don't hear of it. I don't hear of it. We're still politicking education. We're still bothered about mutabak bangsa, mutabak bahasa, mutabak sudahnya. We are talking mutabak, mutabak, orang semua dah go global. Correct? And then we get a shock. Why? We are at the bottom. We started there, we remain there. I'm serious because having leadership at all levels with a vision means like this, you follow the flow. If the flow is globalization and these are the criteria, go there. Regionalization, go there. Adjust, innovate in the university in order to make sure we are competent to meet the challenges of the ASEAN economic community. Because that's where the education people will be. I don't hear of it. Yang sibuk ni business people je. It's a pity lah, because you know why your graduates are going into business, you know? Your graduates are going into business. Mana kalau you buat business, katalah sini, business studies. How many of you actually, like as lecturers, look at from the point of view of ASEAN legal aspects of commerce? You know what I mean? Introduction of ASEAN legal parameters for business. Too late lah, bila SME Core buat dah habis lah. SME Core not competent. I'm just giving you an idea. I can go on for 5 hours talking about this, but I'm just saying. Start innovating where you are. Tak payah tengok, tak payahlah tunggu menteri pelajaran, kementerian pendidikan nak buat. You, your own circle of influence. I asked just now, got 25,000 students in this university. How many circles are there? Tell me. If every circle of influence in this university does what it takes with leadership in every sphere, you'll be really up there in performance. Think about it. So think beyond borders as leaders in your own area and have that open mind, yeah, to absorb what's good in the process of globalization and in the new developments brought about ICT. In essence, when I talk about this, we must have pemimpin sepanjang zaman. We have to have future-proof leaders. That's what Malaysia needs from now on. Future-proof leaders that are not stuck in obsolescence. Maknanya, 10 years down the line, the person is still valid because he or she keeps on innovating and changing according to the needs of the times. That's what we should be grooming. That's what we should be nurturing. And that's what we should be teaching and guiding. Future leaders that are future-proof. Yeah? Jadi maknanya bila sampai 2020, tak boleh pakai lah. Kerana dia fikir 2000 kan dah 2020, dia masih 2000 je bercerita. Right? Bukan no mind change. Jadi bila kita kata future-proof leaders, pemimpin sepanjang zaman, maknanya fahaman-fahaman dia tak usang, sikap dia tak sempit dan tak negatif, persepsi dia tidak terhad, anggapan dia pun tak ada yang tak betul, dan kelemahan dia kalau ada is kelemahan peribadi. You know, these are the apa orang yang kita nak jadi future proof leaders ni, supaya tidak dihalang, dibelenggu oleh semua ni, sangat usang dan sebagainya. Dan kita tahu bahawa persekitaran kita akan terus dinamis. We cannot change the fact that the environment will continue to be dynamic. Inilah switch Malay English ni. Dan dengan itu kita kena faham how to manage the changes, how to incorporate the changes as leaders in your own circle of influence, dan manfaatkan the positive changes, not the negative ones. Not every change is good, you know. Saya bila orang kata, let's change, let's transform. Macam-macam cara nak transform ni kan. So please qualify, transform for the better, change for the better, not just transform full stop. Macamlah kita kata, saran kat university students, move out of your comfort zone. Saya kata, don't be crazy. Why you tell them to move out of their comfort zone? No human being wants to move out of their comfort zone. You tell me that, I say, are you stupid? I'm comfortable. So what do you tell them? Dia tanya I. Tell them, would you like to move up to a higher level of comfort zone? Oh, is that possible? Of course. You may be comfortable now, but don't you want to be more comfortable? Yes. But if you just tell them, move out of your comfort zone, huh? Where do I go? To hell. Betul tidak? Just because it's a catchy to say that. Think before you tell them to do that. I never tell people move out of your comfort zone. It's crazy. But tell them there is a higher level of comfort there, you know? Dia pun tegan kan? Yeah, how? Well, this is what you do, this is what you do. Okay, I'll try. Does it make sense? It does. So, you see, the leader in that circle of influence can move changes without much effort. It's to change the mindset of the people that you lead. Sekarang, satu persekitaran yang sangat penting yang harus diambil kira ialah peranan generasi muda. The Gen Y generation and beyond. Diorang kata generation Z yang coming after Y ni is Gen Y on Red Bull. Itu jari cucu saya yang kecil. Ni. Is Gen Bull. Gen Y. Gen Z which is Gen Y on Red Bull this tu. Mak dia Gen Y. Oh, yalah kan? Y lagi. Anak dia Z on Red Bull. Maknanya not only the characteristics of Gen Y, bertambah dia punya vigor and vim. Why? Because Gen Y ni digital citizens. These are anak-anak perempuan dan tuan-tuan, including anak saya, yang dia internet, virtual reality, instant gratification, yang ada universal values, yang ada new norms, yang mula bercakap soal governance, tadbir urus, sama ada politik atau kerajaan, yang mula bercakap soal telus, ketelusan. Kita dulu pronoun cuma tak reti kan? Dia ketelusan, tadbir urus, semua demokrasi, hak manusia, hak asasi manusia, agenda inklusif, agenda hijau, itu mampan, kempas. Agenda pembangunan mampan, sustainable development, agenda hijau. Semua, workers rights, animal rights mana ada ni? Ini the new universal norms, termasuk anak Malaysia pun dah pandai ni. Correct or not? Why? Because knowledge and information across borders. Now, kita kena manage ni jadi leaders. Yang nak muncul dalam every circle ni must take into account the population structure hari ini dan akan datang. The demographic population has changed. So leadership in all circles of influence must incorporate this. This to me is the most vital to take into account. Inilah budak-budak yang menjatuhkan kerajaan-kerajaan di Middle East. Inilah budak-budak yang menyerang kerajaan, menjatuhkan segala-gala di semua negara yang kita tengok ni in turmoil sekarang. Those are the Gen Y kids. Dia belajar through cross flows of information. Copycats. ISIS ni, budak-budak mazhab ni begini. Saya tak pernah mimpi yang ISIS akan ada pengaruh di Malaysia. I never thought it will happen. It has happened di Kedah, cik. Betul tidak? Hari-hari kita baca akhbar pengaruh ISIS ke anak-anak muda di Malaysia. Something must be wrong there. Something must be wrong about religious education. For them to suddenly think that fighting in Syria is for agama. Killing some innocent people, agama. Killing some innocent non-Muslim is agama. Padahal kita baca, Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. Habiskanlah baca. Apa maksud dia, ya Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun tu? Wahai orang-orang yang tidak mempercayai orang kafir lah maknanya. They don't believe us. Lah, kafir ni bukan buruk. Kafir is not a dirty word. Kafir just means don't believe Islam. That's all. Kepada orang Kristian, kita lah kafir. Pada dia lah. Non-believers. Yeah. Correct. Pada Buddhist, non-Buddhist lah kafir kan? That's what it means. Non-believers. Apa dalam ayat Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun? Itu kamu orang-orang yang tidak mempercayai, tidak percaya Islam, cara mani kan? Yeah, she's not a Muslim. Okay? Kita kata, ni kita sembahyang ni, kita baca ni ayat ni kalau kita baca ayat tu. Kamu sembah Tuhan kamu, aku sembah Tuhan aku. Aku tak sembah Tuhan kamu. Dan kamu tak sembah Tuhan aku. Maka kau sembahlah Tuhan kau. Aku sembah Tuhan aku. Ada ke Tuhan kata kau bunuh dia? Ada. Kalau kita dah baca ayat tu hari-hari, maknanya itulah yang Tuhan suruh kan? Macam mana anak ni boleh terpesong ni? Di mana kepesongan berlaku sehingga boleh bunuh orang kat Syria, cincang kepala orang ni? Atas asas memperjuangkan agama. La ilaha illallah, tiada lain daripada Allah. Apa benda ni? See the mismatch somewhere, not sync. Now, where did it start? Leadership in the keluarga, leadership in where they were nurtured. Maybe schools. We don't know. Maybe ustaz. Kita tak tahulah. Dekat circle of influence ni kan? Kalau tidak, bagaimana kita boleh dipengaruhi oleh ISIS di Malaysia? Saya tak pernah mimpi ini akan berlaku. Kadang saya dah ke Yemen. Saya dah ke Syria. Saya dah ke Iraq. Memang boleh jadi kat situ kita tengok cara. Kalau pergi kat Yemen memang boleh jadi punya. Cara style hidup dia memang boleh jadi macam ni. Kepemisahan antara lelaki dengan perempuan. Yang perempuan ni duduk sekolah, college. Bukan duduk di kursi atau lantai. Tak ada kursi. Yang pergi anak-anak Malaysia pergi ni. Saya berceramah kat dia. Dia duduk kat lantai lah. Dengan sugi. Saya berceramah ni. Saya berceramah. Anak Malaysia. Ni sugi. Lepas tu bila saya ada nota, buku nota kan, saya ceramah dia nota rajin. Budak-budak universiti. Nyak-nyak-nyak, cuk sini. Lepas tu ada pula nota baru, tulis lagi. Tak. Saya dah nak habis tu, saya jijik dah. Saya kata dengan duta, ini dengan sugi ni apa orang Yemen ni? Macam itulah Datuk Seri. Saya kalau pergi masjid, budak-budak kita sama, budak-budak kita dah berjubah lah kan. Pergi wuduk, kan wuduk tu. Ni sugi ni mesti ada. Kerana Nabi kata dia. Masa tu pula ada toothbrush. So okay. Tak apa. Nyak-nyak-nyak-nyak sepoket. Okay. Tapi bila nak wuduk, most of them berasa poket tu kan nak tunduk-tunduk kan. Tak adalah jadi ledge. Kamu letak, aku letak. Wuduk-wuduk-wuduk, ambil aje. Duta kata, take anyone you like. Ni duta cakap ni. Saya tak boleh tengok orang lelaki tu. Pasal tak pergi tempat dia kan. Yang perempuan saya nampak lah. Sugi tu lah masuk mulut. Sugi tu lah masuk buku. Astaghfirullahalazim. Kalau itu ajarannya. Terpesong lah dah kan. Yang awal lah terpesongnya. Jadi di kita ni tak pernah ada macam tu ada ke. Tapi mungkin ada. Di mana tempat-tempat leader. Circle of influence yang kecil-kecil ni yang ekstrim. Yang kita tak sangka. Di situ dia ajar. You see? Leader juga tu, tapi leader penjahanam lah. This is where, as I've said, leadership in every circle must be there to make sure change for the better. Right? Make sure all the nilai-nilai adalah betul. Balik-balik kepada Gen Y ni tadi. Hari ini kita lihat mereka ada norma-norma universal. Anak Jepun, anak Malaysia, anak Hong Kong, anak Amerika sama je. Baju sama, cakap sama, betul tak? Cara lifestyle sama. These are the future generation yang akan jadi pemimpin circles of influence mereka sendiri. Takkah kita takut? Takkah kita risau? Kalau budak-budak ini kita tak bendung dari sekarang. Dengan segala ekstremism yang berlaku dalam semua cuba. Tak usah banyak cakap lah. Ini budak yang matematik. Mak bapak ingat, Mara ingat pergi belajar. Matematik. Bukan yang membuat kira-kira. Dia lain dikira hitung. Ada life size mannequin dikira berapa chest, berapa pinggang. I'm serious, correct? Nah, this bukanlah seorang. Tapi jangan lupa daripada satu lah berkembangnya kan. Kita pun Adam dan Hawa lah tu nyang kita kan. Daripada sepasang ni hamba Allah ni jadi ramai kita ni kan. Berapa bilion kat dunia ni. Don't forget from one parent. So one fitri can create another 100. Kalau dia boleh buat aku lagi hero. Itu I am better. Now think about it. So di mana mula leadership tadi? Rumah, sekolah, correct? University. Jangan nak sibuk aje A je semua. A dalam itu pun boleh juga. No, seriously. The benchmarks we use must be qualitative as well. Not just quantitative. So that our young people are well-rounded. Ni Gen Y ni. Well-rounded in the sense of understanding ethics, understanding principles, understanding integrity, honesty, respect and so on. So that they are brilliant people, yes, tapi rounded up. All the edges have been rounded and tempered to become good assets for the country and for society. So that's what the leaders in every circle of influence must do. And finally, leaders in every circle of influence must remember, it's a two-way process. The leaders influence the environment and shape the environment. At the same time, the environment shapes the leaders. And for the future, it is the environment that's going to have more impact on how the evolution of leaders will be. Because the environment will determine what characteristic of the leaders must be. The changes in the environment as we go on. As technology becomes more extensively used, leaders must then relate to technology. So in other words, the environment will continue now to shape the sifat of leaders. But having said all that, integrity got nothing to do with environment, right? Rajin doesn't mean environment. Discipline got nothing to do with environment, it's you. And of course, vision, having vision is also you. How you manage as a leader, that will be influenced by environment. But those basic traits, which was valid in the year 1500 dulu, will continue to be valid to the year 3000-4000. Right, so that's what I mean by future-proof leaders with the basic characteristics. So, itulah sahaja saya nak beritahu. Kalau ada apa-apa soalan, silalah. I've overshot a bit of the time, but I know, back and forth Malay and English. So, thank you.